In 1918, a graduate student named Masamitsu Oshima traveled to the then Japanese colony of Taiwan with the goal of drawing a detailed map of its freshwater fish population. There he came across an interesting red-spotted salmon specimen that his colleague Takeo Aoki had collected out of a stream high up in the Taiwanese mountains near Taichung. It reminded him of the trout that he saw back home in Japan, but not quite. Oshima told his doctoral advisor, Dr. David Starr Jordan, ichthyologist, first Stanford Chancellor, and infamous eugenicist, about this new specimen, and in November 1919, they announced the discovery of a new species of salmon, the Formosan Landlocked Salmon. It is one of Taiwan's rarest fish. I have a deep passion for fish. Come to the Asianometry YouTube for analysis on TSMC and national politics. Stay for the conservation efforts of a foot-long mountain salmon. But first, I want to take the time to ask you to subscribe to the Asianometry newsletter. Yes, one more. But I'm not going to talk about the post today, just because I want to get on with the salmon stuff, because I'm really excited about it. You can find the link to the newsletter in the video description below, or you can just go to asianometry.com. Subscribe and I'll try to make it worth your while. You can expect a new newsletter every 4 days at 1 a.m. Taiwan time. Much thanks. So, how does a salmon get up the mountains? The salmon's Chinese name literally means cherry hook-kissed mouth salmon. It is a cold water fish about 30 centimeters long. It can be considered a sister subspecies to the Japanese salmon and can be said to be the southernmost natural salmon population in the world. Its body is dark turquoise or green with silver-white colored belly. It has 8 to 12 dark bands on its side, called par marks in the fish world. Along its back, 11 to 31 black spots, and it has a wide hooked mouth. The salmon is a cold water fish and can survive only in temperatures below 16 degrees Celsius. Most of the time, Taiwan is quite warm. A river with water so cold is extremely rare and makes it unlikely that the salmon should have a home here. Thus, it can only survive in streams and tributaries high up in the mountains, over 1,500 meters above sea level. How the salmon made its way up to these mountains remains fiercely debated. Some 10 to 80 million years ago, the salmon's ancestors migrated from the Sea of Japan up Taiwan's rivers. But when the glaciers retreated at the end of the Ice Age, those salmon found themselves trapped on the top of the mountains. Well, that's the prevailing theory. Salmon have a migratory nature. They spawn and are born in the rivers. Then they travel to the sea, where they feed and grow to adulthood. Soon thereafter, they migrate back to the rivers where they are born so that they can breed and lay eggs. The Formosan landlocked salmon has no access to the sea, as the water in the Tachia River's lower reaches are too warm for the fish to survive in. So how can the salmon continue to survive? Dr. Oshima theorized that the salmon would trace its way up and down the river, something that the river's long, relatively flat upper reaches allowed. The Tachia River's upper river basin gave the fish a unique sanctuary to survive tens of thousands of years. As late as 1949, the salmon was widely distributed in streams high up in the mountains of Taiwan. An observation report in the early 1950s found plenty of the fish. The stream water was very clean. I could see lots of fish everywhere. Catching a salmon was easy because at that time only few people lived or visited there, and trees were flourishing along both sides of the stream. The natural environment was not yet destroyed then. But throughout the 50s, 60s, and 70s, the salmon's range shrunk to a single 7-kilometer section in the Chichawan stream in the upper reaches of the Tachia River. Part of the reason for this decline had to do with the further development of Taiwan's central areas. New highways and settlements in the upper Tachia River basin had increased the population from 500 scattered indigenous to 55,000 Weishenren and other settlers. New methods of fishing the salmon population had devastating effect on the population. Using poison, dynamite, and electricity, the fish rapidly declined in numbers. Furthermore, a number of dams built along Taiwan's rivers isolated and shrank the population. The most significant of these dams was the Tuxi Dam, Taiwan's tallest. Completed in 1974, the dam is over 778 feet high and stands as one of Taiwan's proudest engineering achievements. The dam is indeed a beautiful sight and is worth a visit to the Heping district in Taichung, but it and the silt-trapping dams built alongside the river's reaches also presented a significant threat to the salmon by vastly limiting its habitat. Combined with illegal logging activities and deforestation, the salmon has lost a significant amount of what was once its home. Along with the Formosan sycadir and the Mikado pheasant, the Formosan landlocked salmon has become a symbol of the island's natural endemic animal populations. It's featured prominently on the 2000 NTD bill, which I admit is not all that common, along with those other animals. Considering that many such endemic species on islands like New Zealand are usually wiped out with human settlement, that a few Taiwanese animals like the salmon and its ilk have survived is pretty amazing. Taiwan has already lost the Formosan clouded leopard. The salmon deserves to keep surviving. The fish's special traits has been recognized since antiquity. The Aboriginal tribes living in the mountains have fished it for over 4,000 years. They believed that the fish was a gift from their ancestors. In 1938, the Japanese colonial government in Taiwan declared the Formosan salmon a national treasure. It prohibited illegal logging and imposed a fishing moratorium on the species during its breeding season. These protections lapsed once the Republic of China took over from the Japanese after World War II. The ROC pursued economic development, and the salmon's habitat deteriorated for many years. It was not until 1976 when biologists began to raise the alarm about the fish's decline. In 1984, the Taiwan government declared the salmon an endangered species and committed to preserve it. A series of publicity events promoted the salmon's importance as part of nature. On TV and national papers, the salmon would be referred to as the, quote, national treasured fish, end quote, and a symbol of Taiwan's identity. 140,000 tourists visited the Wuling area each year, taking in the natural scenery and learning about the fish. The government worked hard with various stakeholders, including the settlers and indigenous tribes living in the area. Local farmers started a, quote, salmon patrol, end quote, to watch out for illegal fishing, and then, in 1993, the Xie Pa National Park was established to protect the fish's entire habitat. The population rebounded for a little bit, but then has declined from a peak of 2,000 in 1987. A combination of human activities and natural disasters have contributed to this decline. Soon, a debate emerged between the local residents living in agricultural farms near the river and conservationists. The farmers have been there for decades or even longer, but their logging and farming activities disturbed the fish's home, and the fish can't be moved from the river. Removing the silt trapping dams along the Tachio River would also contribute to the fish's future, but in the end it became clear that doing so would certainly cause future damage to the valuable Tachio Dam downstream, due to silt buildup and the like. Eventually in 2000, 5 pairs of wild salmon were collected and placed into captive breeding programs. 5,000 individuals were bred through the aqua farm, while the scientific community debated their release. The question was made moot when in 2004, Typhoon Ariel smashed the farm and released a bunch of them. The result is an increase in the population that continues to this day, but also a corresponding decline in genetic diversity. Scientists continue to study this effect and its long-term impact. The Formosan landlocked salmon is a weird creature. It's nothing like the majestic salmon that we see in the ocean and in the rest of the world. It's rather small and demure. Your first reaction is that it should probably be more of a trout than a real salmon. But there is something about this fish that just really compels me. I just wrote 1,400 words about it. Maybe it has something to do with the microcosm that is Taiwan Island. In one part of the island, you got high-tech skyscrapers and some of the world's most sophisticated technology companies. Just a few hundred miles away, you have dense mountain wilderness and this little beautiful fish. Or maybe it has something to do with its circumstances. Being trapped in a single mountain stream, nearly 2 kilometers above sea level, cut off from the rest of the world. A metaphor for Taiwan itself. Alright everyone, take care of yourselves out there. Like and subscribe, blah blah blah, yada yada. Stay safe. See you later.